Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you, and good for us to be here. And happy Thanksgiving if you're celebrating today or yesterday or tomorrow. It's just a weekend to celebrate and give thanks. We're at the end of our creation time, and it makes sense, right? The end creation time with Thanksgiving. So welcome and happy Thanksgiving to everyone here and everyone online as well. Welcome home. Welcome to Thanksgiving. I have a few announcements for you. Let's start with fun facts, because we're only 2 weeks away from our anniversary, 190 years. Aren't you glad you're not 190? I was thinking of that the other day. It's my dad's 90 on Halloween, and I looked at him and talked. We've been talking, and it's like, wow, but what if you were 190? See, that would be big. Anyhow, fun fact. From 1932 to 1988, St. Andrew's United Church was likely considered the musical hub of Markham due to the Woods family. A.J. Woods was the choir master, his wife Edith was the organist, their daughter Peggy then served as organist and choir director from 48 to 88. Peggy also followed her father's footsteps as she directed and accompanied four Gilbert and Sullivan productions. And these were a great hit with the community between 1953 and 1958. That's quite a history you have here, and I think we should clap for that, right? Look at the history. How many of you remember those days? Anybody? Have a few? Very good. Okay, so on the 190th, we've had over 200 invitations go out. We have had 50 some odd come back with answers. And all but I think six were, they will be with us at some point or throughout that whole weekend. So if you haven't sent back your invitation, your RSVP part to tell us when you will be with us or not that weekend, please do so soon, because we also have to plan for refreshments and for a luncheon on the Sunday. So please let us know your intentions for that weekend and how we'll celebrate together. Also, in your order of service, you have a slip of paper. I think everybody should have one. And we did this last year. It just says, I am thankful for. So I invite you to, as we go through the beginning of the service, think about what you are thankful for. Write it down, a word, couple of words, whatever it is. And then when we're together with the kids, I'm going to be having the kids collect up all the slips of paper, and we're going to be using them for our actual prayers of the people. So take the slips of paper, write on what you're thankful for, and that'll form our prayers today. Also, a reminder to you that we are a busy church. We have Community Cafe in the Friendship Room on Tuesdays, so hopefully you can make it out and just share some time with one another. Also, on October the 16th at 1:30 in the Friendship Room is the Markham Community Seniors Club meeting. So there's a description of that in here. And the bazaar. The bazaar is coming. So we're just going to get through 190th anniversary, and we'll be kicking in here for our bazaar, which is well known as well throughout this neighborhood and beyond. So take a look at the announcements so you don't miss anything and that you can be involved as you're able. Now, thank yous, because it's Thanksgiving. The flowers we have with us today are from the Markham Fair, and I believe it was Judy Bell, is that it, who dropped them off? We think. So anyhow, these are from the Markham Fair, and they are lovely for us for today. And Jeannie has decorated all of our windows just to bring in that sense of the harvest, which is what today and this weekend is all about. So thank you to Jeannie and to the Markham Fair and everybody that gives. And one slightly new thing you'll see in the order of service and on the screens for the next few weeks, or maybe longer, we'll see. I'm putting in the year of the hymn. So when it was written, when the music was written, because it's not always at the same time, right? So you'll see how old the music is that you're singing, or how new it is. Wow. So I thought you might like to do that. A few weeks ago, we talked about the music and the theology and the years. I thought, yeah, let's let you see those little tidbits as we go along. And I hope and I think that is everything. So hear these words from the prophet Joel. Prophet Joel's writing is in what's called the Book of the 12. And it's the 12 prophets that come after the big ones, the big guys, like Ezekiel and Isaiah and Jeremiah. So Joel said these things. Do not fear, O soil. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things. Do not fear, you animals of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness are green. And the tree bears its the fig tree and the vine give their full yield. The children of Zion, be glad and rejoice in the Lord your God, for the threshing floor shall be full of grain, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God. Let's hold this thought, these words, these ancient words, on this Thanksgiving weekend, as we open our heart to God, around us, among us, beyond us, with us, but within us always. Let us open our hearts to each other, here and beyond. And Alan's going to offer us our acknowledgement for justice.
Good morning. Our acknowledgement of the need for justice. We acknowledge injustices inflicted on those who come from many ethnicities, faiths, and societies. Hate has no place in Jesus' teaching, nor should it live within us. We strive to open our hearts and minds and embrace differences. In so doing, we will be examples of the acceptance and the love Jesus had for everyone.
We also light the Christ candle today, as we do every Sunday. The Christ candle is a symbol of love's presence with us this day and always. And that we remember love is with us, God is with us, and what was and what is and what will always be. God just is with us. Thanks be to God. And we come into this space and time together here. We come in with a place and a feeling in of our hearts of contemplation on sometimes it's just the silence we seek. We come into this holy place of prayer and of gratitude. So come into it with all your heart. Come into this place and seek wholeness and hope. Seek strength in belief and feel the belonging you have here. Come into this space and breathe in the essence of God. And through our words prayed and offered and sung and spoken, breathe in God's presence. Come into this space with thanksgiving. Come into this space with peace. And come into this place to sing songs of thanksgiving. Please stand as you're able.
Oh,
Let us pray. Holy God and Creator God, Provider God, provide a world that then can provide for us in return. And we've imagined creation speaking to us, and now we speak back, God, with thanks for the blessing that blessings our world offers. In the fruits of the fields, the trees, the farms, our stores, how we care for each other. We live privileged here, and we are thankful. By our faith and through our discipleship in this gathering, may we be now moved to seek out ways that we might love and serve others, that our thanksgiving becomes true thanks with giving, together and separate, always with and within, the love of the Christ. Amen. You've all noticed the wonder and the beauty of the leaves as they change color, and as I'm in the forest, like that's one of the best parts is the color and then just playing in the leaves. And it's what happens at this time of year and the unfolding of this season. And we do give thanks for the beauty of it all. Like when you're there, when just stepping outside, look at the gardens around our church. And the harvest is in too. And some tables are just so full, and they will be this weekend. And some tables will be very empty. So we bring to God our yearnings for a just and fair world for all, with all, and how we might be a part. Let us pray. Holy God of love and of justice, as we give thanks for our blessings, may we see those who long for what we have. May we hear the suffering and the cries of people and of creation. And by your love within us, may we answer. May our faith be given voice to our minds. May our faith give action to our hands and our resources, that we might then speak and act for a just sharing for all the earth, of good food and fresh water, and warm homes and clean clothes and satisfying work and peaceful enjoyment of life without worries. God, may we in our discipleship turn our thanks into giving in prayers, to an answer to prayers that we hear from all over the world. Amen. Let us be assured that God hears, God listens, and what God hears and listens is the suffering of all of creation, the whole world. That in answer, God is creatively and redemptively at work in the world through and with all of us. And so the blessings we have are the blessings we're invited to share, so that all the world shares in the blessings of life and love. Amen.
Good morning. Oh, happy Thanksgiving. It's Thanksgiving, right? Yes. Hey. Couple things. This song, I wrote this song a number of years ago. It was a song intended to be written about the church, what the church is all about. As it turned out, there's a lot of thankfulness in this song, so it fits for this morning. The other thing I want to mention is this song, when I wrote it, there was no Zoom or people listening in or people watching. But you know what? When I look at the words, everything applies, whether you're here or not. We're all one, and we can all do all these things anywhere, really. So, the song's called The Church. It's a place where we pray, we laugh, we cry, we stay. It's a place where we come to give thanks as one. And we sweep, we cook, we preach. We plan, we think, we teach. We praise, we laud, and we seek to be good as we should. It's a place where we pray. We laugh, we cry, we stay. It's a place where we come to give thanks as one. We have faith as we work and we play. We try to grow with each passing day. We ask the Lord, show us the way. As we live and forgive, it's a place where we pray. We laugh, we cry, we stay. It's a place where we come to give thanks as one. We give, we take, we try to help the needy get by. We smile, we sing to the sky. For the Lord, for the Lord. It's a place where we pray. We laugh, we cry, we stay. It's a place where we come to give thanks as one. We smile, we sing to the sky, to the Lord, for the Lord. It's a place where we come to give thanks as one.
That does go perfectly for today. Rick and I had talked about that a few weeks ago. So let's have some time with the kids. We've got some things to think about today. And God is good? All the time? God is good. So we have a new little friend here, but I'm not sure if our little friend wants to come up. I don't think so. That's okay. All in good time, right? See if she can see? Can you wave to her? Nope, not coming. So this is Thanksgiving weekend, and we spend a lot of time giving thanks. And years ago, I had someone do some work for me about Thanksgiving, and they came back talking about pilgrims in Plymouth Rock, and I thought, what's that about? You know what? That's the American Thanksgiving. It has nothing to do with us at all. But that's why their Thanksgiving's a whole different day. So I thought, maybe we should go back and revisit again. Why do we have Thanksgiving, and where did it come from? So I went looking, because, you know, that's what I like to do, right? And yes, Thanksgiving is all about giving thanks for the harvest. It comes from our European history, our European heritage. That's what they did. They gave thanks for the harvest, for the fall, and all the food that had grown. But the first Thanksgiving by Europeans in North America, that's where we are, right, was held by, they believe, Sir Martin Frobisher, as in Frobisher Bay. Right? He and his crew were looking for a Northwest Passage. They were trying to get through the northern part of what was, it's Canada now. So he and his crew were up around the eastern Arctic in 1578, so long before even this church started. It was northern Canada, or Nunavut. And again around 1579 and around the Newfoundland kind of area. So he spent a lot of time trucking around there with his boats. They ran into all sorts of problems. Think about the weather up by the north on the Arctic and the oceans, and there was ice and there was storms and they couldn't see. And at one point they all drifted apart and they lost sight of each other. So it says that they had had hopes of landing somewhere and starting a settlement and picking up and creating a settlement like back home in Europe. Well, you can't. If you can't even find the land, and you're all split up in your boats. Well, something happened, and there was a clearing, and they ended up finding each other again, right? And that's pretty cool, given the Atlantic. in the north. So what they did was, it was in the fall, they decided they would have a Thanksgiving, like back home in Europe, but also a Thanksgiving for finding themselves, finding each other, and the boats coming back, the ships coming back together again, and the crew. So they did that. They had they had a meal together, and it was a meal of celebration and thanks for the harvest, and also for what they saw as their deliverance, that God was with them. God provided a way somehow for them to come together again. And then in time, which I'll tell you in a second, in time it became a general holiday in Canada. But what they did when they had that dinner together, that meal, they had apparently salted beef, biscuits, and mushy peas. I don't quite know why mushy peas, except maybe they've been around a long time. They weren't canned, I know that. But they had that as their dinner, and they celebrated Holy Communion together, because it is the great Thanksgiving we give in the church. Many churches today will be celebrating Thanksgiving with Holy Communion. So anyhow, a bunch of years later, in 1604, French settlers also came to this area, and they also held feasts of Thanksgiving, because they also came from Europe, and it was about the harvest, about God providing a land and earth and things that would grow to feed us. But it wasn't an official holiday until November 6, 1879, so a little over 100 years ago. And then on January 31st, 1957, anyone remember that day? Just wondering. 1957, January 31st, the Governor General of Canada, Massey, he issued a proclamation stating, a day of general thanksgiving to Almighty God for the bountiful harvest with which Canada has been blessed is to be observed on the second Monday in October forever. And our Thanksgiving is tomorrow, the second Monday in October. So in honor of our tradition, and because we are a church and it's the day we are giving thanks as a church, we all have feasts, right? Everyone has this. So I'm hoping everyone out there has had a chance to write even just a word of what they're thankful for. And what we're going to do is we are going to put our hands together, we're going to say our prayer, and then I'm going to ask you guys to take two bowls, go and collect up all the pieces of paper, okay? And then when you go to Joyful Noise with Michelle, you're going to organize them all, and somebody will bring them back to me. Or you can all come, whatever you would like. And we're going to use all the slips of paper to make today's prayers of the people of Thanksgiving right here again. So let's start with this. Dear Jesus, help me to be honest. Help me to be kind. Help me to be loved. Amen. And here is Jesus taught the first disciples to pray. Our Father, okay, so here's the plan. I'm going to give you guys, I've got two bowls here, but you can also help each other go along and collect up. And I think Michelle's going to go with you as well, so you can collect them up while we all stand to sing and probably scratch something quickly down in the meantime. And so Ted, you go ahead and play. You guys collect up even as you can, and we will, there you go, and we'll sing to sing you on your way out as well. Stand as we're able.
Song of the
be seated. We have one scripture today. It's from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, and it's verses 25 to 34. Now, as we prepare to hear this scripture, we need to remember a couple of things. That this gospel was written probably around 85 AD. And the word gospel, it means good news. So 50 years after Jesus' death and resurrection, this is out there. 50 years later, it's good news for them hearing it, and it's good news for us too. Now, if you were to sit, or if we were to sit and decide to read the whole gospel, which we're not, but if we did, then this gospel contains a great number of references to the Jewish faith, the Jewish traditions, and the Jewish story. It relies on Israel's scripture more than any other New Testament book. So many scholars believe, because of the time it was written, because of the emphasis on the Judaism, that this was intended for a Jewish Christian audience or a Jewish Gentile group of hearers. We can also remember that Jesus says in this gospel that he has not come to abolish the Torah, or the law. He's not come to abolish the prophets either. He's come to fulfill the law and the prophets of the Jewish faith. So Jesus' teaching here is, and in other places, is on how to apply Jewish laws to circumstances of the early Christian church. So let's hear Jesus' teaching to those long ago, and let's also hear how the Spirit might be speaking to us today and inviting us to consider the meaningfulness of the words of their time or our time. And Henry is going to offer us this reading.
Good morning. Today's scripture comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 25 to 34. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap, nor gather into barns. And yet, your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet, I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who seek all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. Today's trouble is enough for today. This is the word of God. Thanks be to the Lord.
God's blessing be added to the hearing of our words today, our words sung, spoken, prayed, and offered. As you know, my family lives far from here, and you're not likely to see them, right? You haven't seen them in a year and a half, so what can I say? And to be honest, sometimes it is sad for me being here, and I can feel alone, but I don't feel alone because you're all here and you're my church family. And then on the other hand, I can share with you stories of the kids, and I don't have to worry about embarrassing them, right? So it sort of works. So here's a story. And actually, Lee does know about the story because he remembers it. The kids were about 4 and 7. They lived Lego. I don't know about your kids, but Lego was the be-all and end-all. I remember standing on it, right? We had a big chest of Lego, and they would spend literally hours playing Lego. They would build cars and transformers and roads and rockets and planes and houses. They'd be all over the house, all over the steps and the hallways. And hours would go by, but I loved listening to their chatter, too. Constant. Well, one night, we were in the TV room, we were watching Monty Python's Life of Brian, and the kids were just outside in the hallway between the bedrooms. They were playing Lego, like usual, right? And we could hear them chatting. Now, when it came to the questionable parts of the video, we would fast forward. Remember VHS? You could fast forward and watch the actual frames go by, then you could stop where you wanted to start again. You didn't have to pick scenes. Well, that's what we were doing. And the movie was over. We got the kids ready for bed. You know, you wash your hair, you wash your face and your hands and do your teeth and say it our family prayers. We had a family song to teach them their address and their phone number. And the usual, the hug and kiss, tuck them in, good night. And all was good until church the next morning. Now, I don't remember why the kids stayed in the service. Whatever it was, it was. Reverend Dick Prince was reading the scripture. Oh, it was good. Today's scripture, exactly. And that's why it hit me. And when he was done, in that moment before he began the message, in that moment of quiet in the church, Lee turns and says, "Hey, Mom, Reverend Dick must have watched Life of Brian last night because he knows all about lilies in the field, too." So you know everyone heard those words, everyone, and I felt like 100 pairs of eyes all turning on me, not on him. And I was like, oh my goodness. But what I really wondered later too was, how could Lee, and I presumed Josh, who was younger, how could they have heard anything about that movie when they were busy playing Lego and talking? How could they have heard what was happening in the other room? But then I thought, you know, kids, they have superpowers, right? Don't they all have superpowers for hearing? And then they report it back to you when you're not ready or out of the blue at the worst time. But then I was thinking, too, because it happened later, not with the kids, with someone else. That line about lilies in the field, it gets used a lot. And I wonder, is there something about that line? Is it the way it rhymes? Is it the words, the image? But somehow that line gets repeated by many people and in many situations, and usually with the intention, a good intention, to tell people to remember to believe that God provides for the lilies, so God will provide for you too. But what exactly does God provide? Like, does that work for everyone? And would it work? Would hearing those words work for someone who is hungry or starving today? Would they believe God's providing for them? How does this whole image work? What does it mean? And what about those in Florida right now with the catastrophe of the destruction of so much down there? How's God providing down there or anywhere? Or what exactly does God provide? So even Ted and I had this conversation the other day, philosophical conversation. What does God provide? So I went back. Let's go back and see what else Jesus was saying. Just before the words Henry read, Jesus had been giving his hearers, his disciples, instruction to beware of practicing your piety so that others can see. Because that means it's really only about you, making yourself look and feel good and really doing nothing authentically. Then Jesus said to them, don't pray like the hypocrites, making it all visible and loud like a big performance, because that's really only about you too, and it doesn't do much for anyone else, that's for sure. Not going to solve their hunger, and they can tell. Then Jesus talked to them about how to pray to God, beginning with praise and about our relationship, God in heaven, us on earth. And then next, with a commitment to obedience to the divine will, your kingdom come, God. Then a petition for our daily bread and forgiveness of our debts, which they considered sins. It's an interesting dialogue there. Even as we have forgiven those who were indebted to us. You got to think on that one. And then finally, there is a plea to God to not be brought to trial or temptation, but to be rescued by God from the evil one they knew as Satan in their time. Then Jesus goes into today's passage about, you know, the birds and the lilies, and don't store up your earthly material treasures, and you can't serve two masters, money and God, and don't worry, God provides. That's an interesting big chunk and journey, right? And how does that fit together? And after all those instructions of right and wrong, of piety and prayer, I don't know, if I were them, I think I would have a lot to worry about. But when we hear the words God will provide, or if we say them to someone, have we ever done that? What are we really saying about our belief about God, or about our belief about God, what God will provide or not provide? And what are we saying, what's behind, or what are we saying about our belief, or what are we insinuating on the circumstances of someone? If it doesn't appear like God's providing for them, how do we explain that? How do we reconcile that situation? So again, I think we go back to Matthew. And if we remember, this gospel is written for those who knew their Jewish history, they knew their Jewish faith, they just likely might have remembered Genesis 22, verse 14. Because that's where it talks about God will provide. That's where it's rooted. And the Lord did provide. The Lord provided a ram for Abraham so that he did not have to sacrifice his son. You know how strong Abraham's faith was? Like, it was unbelievably strong. Before climbing up the mountain with his son to do the whole sacrifice thing, Abraham tells his servants, and you see this better in Hebrew, because in English I think we gloss over it. He tells his servants to stay there, wait there, because they will be back. He hasn't gone up yet. He knows what he's supposed to do, but he trusts, and his faith is so strong. He knows they will be back somehow, in some way. He knows they will be back. And he trusts that God will provide something that changes the path it looks like they're on, because God will not backtrack on God's promise to Abraham to be the father of a multitude and a nation. Abraham's faith was so deep, so strong, that for me, I look at this story and I think it's not about the obedience to God as much as it is about the depth of that faith, that you have no worries because you trust something will open. And it may be a surprise. It may not be what we expect, but God does provide. And so in this case, God did provide. God provided the ram, but God honors God's promises, and in this case, sustains that relationship between father and son, too. So what else is it that God provides? And what about now and today? If we return to the reading, we might zero in on another question first. Why did Jesus start talking? He was talking about prayer and piety, and then he starts talking about birds and lilies. After telling the disciples all this other stuff, how does that fit? Well, we can understand partly that if animals were created by God to serve humankind and without trouble, that that's the way it was supposed to go, and humans are created to serve God and without trouble, what's the way it's supposed to go, but that doesn't do it for me. There must be more to this. What is underneath the words of being clothed by God like the lilies are clothed? What is it to have no worries, or at least for today? So for this, we need to remember again the connection between Matthew the writer and his Jewish Christian hearers. And the connection seems to be back in Deuteronomy 28. It's the conclusion of Moses' second address to the people, and it's about obedience to God's commandments, actually. Because it says, blessings come with obedience, and without blessings, well, the message is, you better look at reforming your ways of living. Moses says, if you will only obey the Lord your God by diligently observing all the Lord's commandments that I am commanding you today, says Moses, then the Lord your God will set you up high above all the nations of the earth, and blessed you shall be in the city and in the field. Blessed you shall be the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground and your livestock, and blessed will be your basket and your kneading bowl, and blessed shall be you when you come in and when you go out, and the Lord will establish you as God's holy people, as sworn to you if you keep the Lord's commandments, and if you live and walk in the way of the Lord. So what are those commandments, and what's the way of the Lord? Moses sums it up, and so does Jesus. It is to love your God with all your heart, your mind, and your strength, and to love your neighbor, every single neighbor, as you would yourself and as you love your God. And Jesus says, love one another, right? Be stewards of creation as well as there. Honor the relationship that God has established with and among you, with people and all creatures and all the earth. Follow God in that entirety. Sometimes we hear the expression, O ye of little faith, you heard that read today. Jesus said it to his disciples. But maybe it's an invitation for each of us to self-examine our faith, our belief and our faith in loving God and following God with all our heart, mind, and strength. Maybe it's an invitation to even ask of ourselves, what's our understanding of what it is God provides or doesn't provide? We know nature shows us God provides as the harvest demonstrates. We have a world that can feed the world. And for this we give thanks for our blessings. And through the generations, there's been much thanksgiving to God. But God also provides the laws and the commandments as written in Genesis and by Moses and Deuteronomy. They are laws for living in relationship with one another. And these are sustaining and nurturing laws for our relationships with each other, with all people, and with the lilies of the field, or with all of creation. And when we honor that and are obedient to that kind of law of living to relationships, then yes, the lily grows without fear of pollution or contaminated soils, and it will grow by the will of God into a beautiful flower, and we grow too. When we can live without the fear of hunger or starvation or loneliness, then we all can grow. But we who have must care for those who have not. And you know that difference is growing these days. We must learn to share. And as Moses said, when we follow our God, and as Jesus said too, then blessed you shall be, blessed all shall be, really. So don't worry about tomorrow, Jesus said. For tomorrow, it has its own worries to come. Don't worry about that. Worry today about what you're doing today. Focus on today where your faith is. How are you trusting in God today? How are your relationships today? And what more can we do to help one another? Because if we make this our focus daily, then the daily troubles can be blessed away. We pray, hallowed be your name, God. Your kingdom come, God, on earth as it is in heaven. So may that kingdom of bounty come, that we might be clothed like the lilies, well, not of material possessions at all, but clothed with the nurturing and sustaining wonders of a natural world that is beautiful and powerful, and that has a harvest of fruits and wheat and vines and water and all the things that allow the creation to grow and serves and nurtures us too. But we are also nurtured and we are sustained by our homes, our faith, our hope, the love of family, of this church family that I feel. This also is what sustains us. So Jesus said, ye of little faith, well maybe it's turn it around. Ye of great faith, be of great faith. Maybe that's what Jesus' message is. Strive to have the great faith that Abraham had, that no matter, look what was he was heading into, even his faith was so deep, even that was not going to curtail him from God. And that no matter what unfolds, God is there with you. Be of great faith because God already provided. God already provided the ram. God already provided Jesus the Christ and the way and the truth and the life for all of us, right? God does provide, just not always in ways we'd expect. So let's seek and live the kingdom of God. And by living according to God's laws and God's commandments and God's love revealed by the Christ. And let's go be like lilies of the field and with all of creation. Let's be clothed and let's clothe the world with life abundant and love abundant. Let that be the spirit and the breath that we breathe and that we give as the Spirit of God lies within us and moves us to so give thanks. Answered yet. May this be so. Amen. You notice one of the kids or someone dropped me the piece of paper of things all summarized in little notes, so I have it all. We remember today in our prayers those among us who are struggling in body, mind, or soul, or those dear to us or beyond us. We remember the people around the world in war-torn areas where the wars are so senseless, what war isn't, but also where there are struggles with nature, nature's turbulence as well. Let us pray. And as I come to the words, listening God, I invite you to say, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Creator God, we see the beauty, the absolute beauty all around us in animals, like birds of the air and the fish in the seas and the scurrying of squirrels and sounds of bumblebees and the beauty in the leaves of autumn and even in a new way, like the blossoms of spring, but we're reminded of how beautiful the world is and how interwoven the life of all living things are. And we give thanks. Listening God, hear our prayer. Nurturing God for the rains that drench the earth, for the sun that warms the air, for the nutrients that feed the seeds in the soils and that make the harvest grow, we give thanks. We give thanks from the depths of our hearts. Listening God, hear our prayer. Sustaining God for the love of family and friends, for our work to be obedient to your will, to live and to love with concern for each other, for the caring for strangers and from strangers, for the life and the love made known through the Christ to be our way for life and our truth for living. We do commit ourselves. We commit ourselves by faith to follow, and we give thanks. Listening, God, hear our prayer. From our hearts, through our hands today, God, we give thanks for these things. God, we're thankful for our family, all that has happened in families in the past and the present, and families yet to come, yet to be birthed into newness. God, we give thanks for your love, for the love of Jesus and for the food we eat. We give thanks for the earth that we live on and our homes. We give thanks for St. Andrew's and the staff and all the community here. We give thanks for music and health and friends. We give thanks for community and Mother Nature, for the healing of our body, and thanks to doctors and medication and prayer too that makes it happen. God, we give thanks for our children and our grandchildren and honey and bees. We give thanks for Canada. We give thanks for a successful surgery. We give thanks for everyone in the medical profession, the PSWs and the nurses and the doctors, for all they do, working tirelessly every day, holidays or not. We give thanks for each other, God, those here and those beyond here. Our hearts are full of thanks. Listening, God, hear our prayer. God, hear our prayer of thanks this day. And with hearts overflowing with gratitude, we also still hear the suffering of people, the suffering of the earth, sometimes caused by the turmoils of our own histories and our insensitivity to the life of others, and sometimes it's creation's own turbulence or both. But God, we pray for an end to wars because they harm people and the earth. We pray for a healing of lands where there's drought and famine, or where there's been lost harvests or stolen crops. We pray for places that have been destroyed because of hurricanes and tornadoes. Remember Florida today. We remember all places where flooding takes away from what water could normally do to enrich. God, we pray for full tables to relieve the hunger of those who have none. We pray for homes for those who see no hope in ever being able to have a home. God, we pray for wholeness for the world. Listening, God, hear our prayer. And God, hear our prayer of trust, that we believe by faith that all is possible, even when we don't understand and don't know what to expect. God, for those among us and dear to us, for healing, for mending, we pray now. We pray for such wonders to happen through the natural ways, through the ways of faith, that we offer now all that we hold in the depths of our hearts, and that we give to you in the silence. Listening, God, hear our prayer. Ever-present God, hear our prayers this day of thanks, of trust, of hope. Hear our prayers that come from faith. Hear our prayers and our trust in your love that dwells with and within us all. And may we together answer. And clothed in love, love abundant and life abundant, may we give to make to make our thanks known and real and incarnate with Christ. God, may we turn our thanks and our prayers to real giving. Listening God, hear our prayers. Amen. Henry's going to offer us our invitation.
As gratitude is the foundation of our giving, within today's gratitude and every day's thankfulness for all our blessings, let us give for the life and the work of our church family here at St. Andrew's. May we give with hearts full of thanks.
Let us pray. God of all peoples, God of all places, we present the offerings we've prayerfully planned and committed, what we've gathered from our resources in new ways these days, what we've brought in from our hearts, by our faith, a deep faith that we pray is growing as deep as Abraham's. We gather all of this into the way we give, but always giving to serve in Christ's name. Holy One, we present also ourselves, all that we have been, all that we are, all that we shall become, and I resolve each of us and all of us to walk in your way. May all that we offer become blessings of life and love. May those who give and those who receive know that constant presence. May they know the truth of your love through our thanks and through our giving. Amen. I think this song is newer to us. Am I right? Yeah. So we have sung it, but not in a while. So give yourself some gentleness as we sing it together. I think Ted's going to play it through once first. Easier, right? We have come gathered together on this Thanksgiving weekend. We have come as the church, even as Rick sang. We've come with thankfulness in our hearts. So let's now go to serve. Let's go serve that our thanks are turned into giving. For God provides. God provided. God always provides. And in surprising and divine ways. And we're a part of it all. We are a part of the providing. We're a part of being part of the world and serving and caring for one another. So let's continue to be the best church we can be, to and for and with each other and those beyond our doors. Amen. Love of God surround you, that peace of Christ dwell deep within you, and the compassion and thankfulness and caring of the Holy Spirit, let it flow to and through you this day and always. And happy Thanksgiving, everyone. Let's all come and wave happy Thanksgiving to those online.